Okay, welcome back to another episode of Comedy Pinata, live from Zanies. As always, we got to thank our sponsor, SueTheCollector.com, credit cards, student loans, mortgages, car loans, hospital bills. Did you know you have a lot of rights if these go to debt collections? That's right, consumers, not debt collectors, have a huge list of rules they have to abide by, and that's where the law firm SueTheCollector.com comes in. SueTheCollector.com is a national consumer law firm that only helps customers. The lawyers at SueTheCollector have helped literally thousands of people turn the tables on debt collectors and put an end to illegal harassment, abuse, and repeated phone calls that many people find themselves subjected to through no fault of their own. The lawyers at Sue the Collector can help everyone in all 50 states. They've won millions for consumers over the years and have canceled over $1 billion in consumer-related debts. That's right. That's a billion. So right now, they really want to speak to anybody that's had their car repossessed. Did you know that consumers do not have to allow repo men to take their cars against their will? In most cases, you can actually legally refuse to let them take your car. If you've ever objected to a car repo and they still got your car against your will, you may be sitting on a very valuable case. So call Sue the Collector's office right now at 1-877-BAD-REPO or 1-877-223-7376. Again, that's 1-877-BAD-REPO or 1-877-223-7376. Again, ready to take your call, 1-877-BAD-REPO. Oh, my very special guest, hi. My lovely wife, Jessica, Jessica Byrne. So I thought it'd be fun to have you on because comics, we sit here, we watch the clips, we break them down and talk about our friends. But I thought it'd be interesting to have you on because you're the subject of jokes.
Sometimes.
And then you've been a part of the jokes. So right. I thought it'd be funny to have you along to hear your perspective on this stuff from from the perspective of the wife of a comedian,
yes.
Which would be fun. So my first question to you is how...
Yes,
how nervous are you right now?
Very.
Okay.
I should have taken that guy up on the tequila shot.
No, you're going to be fine. You're going to be fine.
Yeah, I'm a little nervous. I don't like to talk in front of people.
Yeah, as you're crying. You're literally...
I'm not crying.
You're tearing
up. No, I'm not
up.
Crying. This is just me happy and excited, and sometimes my my eyes water a little bit.
Yeah, you're tearing up.
No, I'm not crying.
Okay, but you're... Okay, well, you're tearing up. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay.
Maybe it's the lights.
All right. So what is it like when I've asked you for permission on certain jokes to do, and there's only been one I think you ever said you can't do that. And I was exaggerating, obviously. Do you remember the joke?
No, I don't remember the joke, but there's only been one time out of all the jokes that I've been a part of or the content you've told, like... When my parents and my aunt and uncles come to a show and you're doing doggy style, like I didn't say no to that.
That was the first time.
They ever met you?
They ever
like
met
my
me.
Extended
they didn't even
family
speak
met
to me,
you.
And then I'm on stage doing doggy style jokes. And I'm not just doing like a dog. I'm literally on all fours, banging my head against the wall, doing pretending to be a girl, getting drilled from behind.
Yeah.
And it's like, hi, I'm Steve. I'm dating your daughter.
I'm dating your daughter.
So what is that phone call like when your parents call you?
Oh, no, we didn't talk about it. We didn't talk about the jokes.
Oh, you didn't even discuss it?
No, I'm not going to have that. I felt so uncomfortable.
Yeah.
No, but there was that. There was that one that you do when you're at the hotel room and you hear people having sex. Like that one happened on stage, too, in front of my family.
Yeah.
I don't know if you ever did mac and cheese, but...
I'm sure I did. They all came.
All
of them.
Anyways, I never said no to any of those.
Yeah.
And I don't remember the joke that I actually said no to.
I think there was a joke I had done where it was just something, and you said, I sound like a crazy person.
Yeah.
Please don't do that.
Right, because I had been with you.
Yeah.
I was at the show. I was sitting in the back, and...
Oh, I came on stage. You were crying.
Was I crying?
Oh, yeah.
Because I remember... Okay, we don't need to put this out there that I cry all the time.
No, you don't. You don't. But
no, but because I was I remember I was sitting at the bar in the back by myself, and there was this table in front of me of women, and you told the joke.
Yeah.
And it wasn't, it was like they weren't laughing because, oh, Steve is funny. It was like they were laughing at me, and I felt, I don't know, I didn't like it. And I think we were walking home to the hotel afterwards. And I've never said this to you, but I'm like, nope, you're not doing that one on stage.
Yeah.
I don't like it.
But they were laughing, right?
Yeah, they were laughing. Yeah. They were laughing, but I still didn't want you to do that one. Yeah. Yeah, that's the only time.
Yeah, I agree. And there, the one that we're going to show later on today, you had all the right in the world to be like, that might be a bit much.
Oh, yeah.
And we'll get into it. But yeah. But I like, at the time, I thought the bit was funny. I think it's still pretty funny, but I understand how that could be outside the realm of, like,
yeah,
the boundaries of...
But it was an actual reaction you had, so...
yeah, okay. That's right, yeah. But I've done my best to, like, wean myself away from, you know, including too much. There's comics that I think go way deep with including their family. And even on social media, I don't think I've ever posted a picture of us, because I try to be protective of you and the kids,
because
people are just mean. They say awful things about my act, about me, every post.
Yeah.
And I never wanted to do that to you so that you would...
Oh, I'd cry.
Cry.
For sure.
So let's get through this episode without you crying.
No, I'm not crying.
No, I know. But I never wanted to do that. But then this was the one thing where doing this podcast has been so fun. I thought, boy, it would be kind of cool, like, to have you on at least one. Because even if you type my name into Google, the first thing that comes up is Steve Byrne wife.
Yeah.
And we've never posted anything. But I was like, oh, well, you know, maybe at some point we'll do something fun. But then this happened. So thank you again for doing this.
Yeah,
I
you're
appreciate
welcome.
It.
Might be the one and only.
I'm sure this. Okay. Well, let's get into it. So this is the first clip. I think this is probably just me. It's me, yeah. This is me. Okay, so I'm not sure which clip this is that we're going to start off with, but I'm sure it involves you in some form or fashion. I know the second one is definitely going to.
Okay.
So we put the headphones on for this, Jess.
Okay.
And watch this. And okay, here we go. I think you'll know this one.
I live, like I said, downtown Los Angeles. We were walking to lunch one day. We ran a corner. And in the middle of the sidewalk, broad daylight, there's a homeless man squatting down, taking a shit. He looks up at my wife and he goes, "Well, hello, beautiful." She is horrified. And I can't stop laughing. I cannot stop laughing. We go to lunch. I enjoy lunch. She can't eat for some reason. I don't know what the hell her problem is. We get up to leave. She's like, by the way, we're not walking. I'm like, the fuck we aren't. We're walking back exactly that way. Exactly that way. We walk back that way. And now this man is being arrested. He's up against a wall, no pants, being placed under arrest. And for the story, if you're wondering what happened, the shit's still there. Just nobody cleaned it up yet. So he's being placed under arrest. And he looks at my wife. And this is what he said. This is what goes down. He's like, "Well, you don't know who the fuck you motherfuckers are." "Well, hello again." She started dry heaving. She was dry heaving, and tears of joy were streaming down my face. I was like, this dude has no pants. He's getting placed under arrest. He just took a shit, and sex is still on his mind. That dude is fucking awesome!
All right, well...
I will pay his bail. You don't lock him up. We need him out here!
That joke, obviously, it's changed. It's like I'm watching that going, oh, it's changed so much more. It's better, and it's actually, like, sometimes used as a closing bit. But you can attest...
Oh, that happened. Whenever I come to your show and I'm backstage, whoever I'm standing around always looks at me and they're like, "Did that really happen?" Like, yeah it happened, unfortunately.
Yeah, there are some jokes I think that get exaggerated or it's like it goes to a place where it's like there's some semblance of truth. But that one, beat for beat, that is exactly what happened.
Yeah. I think we were going to Umami Burger to eat lunch, and I was like, "Nope, I'm not eating."
You didn't eat lunch that day. You did. You weren't in the mood. But then, we were getting up. You're like, "We're not going home." That
same
way. Yeah,
I didn't want to walk that
way. And I was
way.
Like, "Fuck that. We're definitely going home." I pray
to
God he's there.
I didn't need to see that again. Because that's not the only time I've seen a grown man take a shit on the sidewalk in downtown, unfortunately.
Right. Well, there was that time we went out afterwards, and I was drinking, and I apologized repeatedly for it. I was like, Jess, I couldn't wait. I'm sorry. But you had seen multiple times. Yeah, because we lived in downtown.
Because we lived down there.
We can take these off.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Unfortunately, but no, I didn't want to walk. I didn't want to walk back that way. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
But so when you're seeing that play out, I think that might have been the first joke that we had an experience together. Where I put it on stage. And I remember we were in the writer's room at Sullivan and Son, and I told the story to the writers, and they were dying laughing. And I was like, holy shit, it's a bit.
I have a
new bit now. And I pretty much told it just like that. And the bit just took off. And that was one of those where sometimes you have a story and you take it on stage and it's just not connecting. And it's, I don't know, but this one was just like from A to Z, it's just always worked.
Yeah.
But this was one of the first experiences we shared.
and that, I think it happened early on when I first moved in with you.
Yeah.
So like our relationship was still a little bit newer. We had that shared experience together. And then you decided to share it with everybody.
And then you're at lunch, and you're crying, and I'm writing down furiously
notating
everything.
Let me not forget this.
Yeah. But what is it like for you to see something that was a shared experience for the first time, like on stage, and then into a special?
Well, I mean, that is fun.
Yeah.
It's crazy, but it was a fun story.
Yeah.
Because I know over the years. Like you don't do it so much anymore, but you used to run jokes by me.
And why don't I run it by you anymore, Jessica?
Because
I cry.
I know. Well, because you always you present them to me in the beginning stages, and you see how it's going to be funny, but I don't.
What is your normal reaction like, when I run a joke by you?
Yeah, that'll be good.
That will be good. Not it is.
No, that's or, great, hon. That'll be good.
Or even like you could just courtesy laugh. Like, I don't even get a courtesy. I get that look. Like, that'll be good.
So anyways, you've stopped.
I've stopped.
Yeah, you've stopped.
I don't run jokes by you anymore.
Yeah. I like to. Now I am crying. From laughing. But no, that was a fun one. That is a fun joke.
Yeah.
Just because it's crazy.
It's so crazy. He's hitting on you. And then when he said, well, hello again, it's like, even if he didn't say anything again, right? And he's getting arrested, and that could be part of the story. I think if I was writing it, I'd have to write a line. I'd have to be like, well, he's got to say something.
Yeah.
Well, hello again is fucking perfect. It's like a chef's kiss. It's like, I couldn't write that any better. Well, and it was the way he said it too. And he was yelling at them, and he stops and looks at you.
It's like everything else stopped around him. Like, it doesn't matter that there's police officers around. There's other people watching this whole thing
play. The
whole debacle. Yeah, it didn't match. Everything stopped, and then you saw us walking.
And then he saw you. Well, hello again. Oh, my God. I almost called the special, well, hello again. But I was like, I can't, like... Base the title of an hour off of a shit joke.
Yeah.
Basically,
yeah,
is what it is.
It was a shit joke.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's one of my favorite shit jokes.
It was good.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was good.
Okay. So that's going to tether us into this next part.
Yeah?
Okay. Because I'm pretty sure this next clip is me.
Okay.
This one's a little bit of a long. Yeah. This is me. So this is where. This is a joke where, again, we mentioned this earlier, where it was like, maybe I shouldn't do this because any woman is emotionally invested in their physical appearance, right?
Sure, yeah.
And there are times where a woman could find themselves, you know, very upset about, you know...
A comment or a sound or a gasp or a... that is made by their...
Gasp.
Whatever you did.
Yeah. But I did this joke, and then I had to make it so that I'm the butt of the joke.
Right.
Because I couldn't just, I don't know, like throw you under the bus, right? Not that I'm throwing you under the bus, because whatever. But
maybe
we'll
watch
the joke.
You look like a dick if you did that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And my manager at the time said, you shouldn't do that joke. don't do that joke. It's offensive.
Oh, really?
It's the most offensive joke that I've seen in a while. And I was like, what the fuck?
I want to know what manager that was. Anyway, tell me later.
All right, let's watch this together.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go.
I got to preface this next part with letting you know, my wife has got a big ass.
Out of the gates.
I am not speaking out of school. She'd be the first to tell you or admit it. She got a big butt.
Like, okay, can we pause it? would you admit that? Or
yes.
Or is that something where you're like, I'm not, it's not big? Or what do you think?
No, I mean, I do. It is a family trait, unfortunately. My sisters both do.
Yeah.
Like, it's my mom's side of the family.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It is what it is.
Like, if you go into a nightclub, you're a black man's kryptonite. Okay, let's continue. Here we go.
Behind you, but like, oh, I bet she's married to a professional athlete. You got what? Like, if you saw my wife from behind, you'd be like, oh, I bet she's married to someone that always votes Democrat. I don't think you guys, okay. Like, if you saw my wife from behind, you'd be like, oh, I bet she's married to someone that owns at least one Tyler Perry DVD.
There we go. There we go. Trailer breadcrumbs.
A black guy, he got it. A black guy, there we go. Black guy. So go on. This laundry pile, the first thing I pick out are these cut-off sweatshorts that she wears. I wasn't even thinking, just reflexively this comes
out. Okay, pause. Can you pause this? Now, this is true. This is true because we were beginning to, like, we're dating now, obviously.
I think I had just moved in with you.
We're folding laundry together, so this happened.
Yes.
Okay. Again, this is something that happened in real life where you take it to stage, okay? So I forgot the setup to this because I haven't done the joke since I filmed it.
Yeah.
Out of respect. Okay. Here we go.
Hold them up. I go, whoa. Everything got quiet. Everything. Even the guy golfing on TV was.
I forgot about that.
The way I said whoa is not the way any woman would like to hear her waistline described. The way I said whoa is the way you say whoa when you see the Grand Canyon for the first time. Whoa! Not pants. Not pants. So I know I messed up, right? And I slowly look over at my wife, and I see the tear.
We're crying again.
No, it didn't drop, so it's not official, okay? We've all had tears peekaboo, they go back in. So to me, unless it's moonwalking on that cheek, I don't give a shit. Your feelings ain't hurt. It's not a real tear. But I know I messed up. And I'm like, I'm so sorry. I love you. I love you so much. I wasn't thinking, get out. Get out of this house. I got it. I'm going to fold it all. Go get some fresh air. That's what you should. Take a lap around the neighborhood. Take a long lap around that. Take a few laps. Get those laps in. I'm not saying you need the exercise. That's not what it's. You know, I love you. And I love your ass. And you think about this. A few years ago, girls spend thousands of dollars on surgery to get fat sucked out of their ass. Now they get surgery to get fat put in their ass. And you don't need it because you already got the fat. I'm going to shut the fuck up. That's when my wife walked over to the laundry pile and she picked up my boxer briefs and she goes, medium.
I had to save you.
No, I know. I know.
I had to save me.
Yeah.
All right, so that's the bit, right? The whole, okay.
Yeah.
That's it. I got to tell you, I'm watching it. I haven't seen the bit since I did it because are you okay?
Yeah, I'm just fixing my hair.
What are your thoughts when you watch that?
It is funny.
Okay.
No, it is funny on stage.
Yeah.
And you had to put in the comment I made at the end to save yourself.
Right, right.
Even though
that
I didn't really
didn't
say
happen.
That. Yeah.
That part didn't happen.
Yeah, because I really think I was probably crying.
You were crying that day, I remember, because you were sensitive, as any girl.
Yeah.
Woman would be sensitive about that stuff, but
now if you said something like that, I mean, we've been together long enough,
you wouldn't
but
care.
It was early enough in our relationship that
yeah But I mean, when even in the setup, it's pretty harsh. Like, I'm watching it now, I'm like, ah, oh, you could have softened that a bit with it just like coming out of the gates of like, if I was to do this bit again, I would soften the intro of like, my wife's got a big ass. Like, I'm just saying, like, oh my God.
Right,
like,
out of the gates.
Just, yeah. But when you first saw that, was it like, oh God, like, do we have to do this?
There was definitely a moment when I wasn't sure.
Yeah.
But I was okay with it.
Yeah.
I mean, anytime I saw you do it, it always went over well with the crowd. They thought it was funny, and I do have a big ass. If the joke works.
So you heard it here.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't, yeah. I wasn't, yeah. Again, I wasn't speaking out of school, like I said,
no.
The thing. But has there, since then, knowing the pendulum swing of like the parameters in which I'm to work in, I don't think there's been anything since, right?
I was just thinking that too. I don't think so. I don't think you've done, no.
Even with the kids.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
No.
But the kids have been providing
content.
Oh my God. Will you tell them what Kent said with the chill? With...
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. So
our Kent, son is,
he's six.
Perspective, 6 years old.
Yeah, he's
and
six.
He's, I think what happens is they're discovering, because I've seen on the YouTube channel at home that they type my name in.
Oh,
they're
they
watching.
Do?
They're watching.
Oh, great!
Clips of mine.
They're gonna see doggy style.
But my son has.
Do you remember when we? Sorry to interrupt.
It's okay.
Remember when we went on our honeymoon?
Yeah.
And we were at the hotel, and we were checking into the hotel,
yeah.
And you said your name, and they were getting checked in, and you had walked off, and I kind of went to the left of the front desk,
yeah.
And I saw the guy's computer, and there was a video of you doing doggy style. I'm like, oh fuck! Are you kidding me?
That's
like,
hilarious.
That's what our kids are going to see.
Yeah. Well,
I
had the video. I had the one joke about Livy discovering me on an iPad and, like, seeing me, like.
Oh, yeah.
That might have been too far.
Yeah. Maybe.
Looking back on. Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Maybe.
But my son, he's very creative, and he retains lines or hears things and then sporadically, like, pulls them out like an ace at the right time.
He's you.
He's very, very, he's got
you.
Good comedic timing.
Yeah, for sure.
But tell him what this.
Recently.
And then you called me and said.
I know, because you were getting on a flight. You were like boarding a flight when it happened. And of course, it was one of those mornings where there was like a field trip and we had lots to do and it was rush. He comes walking into.
But this, just to set this up,
yeah.
Though, too. You don't call me going, do you want to know what your son said? You don't, you're a cool mom. You go, do you want to hear what your son said? And you're laughing. And I'm like, oh my God, this is great. Let me get a pen. So this is what happened.
So he comes walking into our bathroom as I'm getting ready. And he's like, Mom, my butt, it really stings. I'm like, okay, do you need me to help you wipe it? Because for those of you who have children or don't, when they first, you know, start pooping and they need help wiping, Kent
sure.
is past that.
Yeah.
But every once in a while.
There's a yard
help.
Sale.
Yeah, exactly. So he says his butt is stinging. He's like, I went poop. I said, okay, I'll help you. Come in the bathroom and I'll help you. So he bends over, hands down on the ground, ass up in the air. And his pants are down. And I'm like, holy Kent, like it's everywhere. Like, you know, yellowish, brownish, everywhere.
Yeah.
So I grab toilet paper and I start wiping and it's not coming off.
Right.
And I'm like, Kent, how long ago did this happen? It's like crusted to your butt. He's like, I don't know. And so I keep wiping. I said, you're going to have to take a shower. Like, it's not coming off your butt and it's everywhere. You can't go to school like this. I said, you need to get in and scrub with soap. And he's like, when? I'm like, right now, get in, hurry.
Yeah.
We're running late. You need to get in. He sits up. He looks at me and he goes, pranked ya. I'm like, excuse me? He's like, pranked ya. I'm like, what do you mean, pranked me? He's like, oh, I had this marker and I decided to color. I'm like, you cut in my head. I'm like, you colored around your butthole and in between your cheeks all over the place. I'm like, Kent, where did you like think of this prank? He's like, oh, I just thought of it on my own. I'm like, oh God.
But then we were talking on the phone. He said, I was coloring this morning. And I thought, oh, this marker looks like a number two.
So guaranteed,
he
stood up on his bathroom counter. Oh, I looked in it. Turned around, so his butt is to the mirror, and he's sitting and coloring in there. It's like, I'm gonna go get mom.
But the story I was talking about was the chill.
Oh, I thought that's what you were talking about.
No, the chill story.
What did he just say? I forget. Chill. Oh, he said he told me to chill with my bullshit.
Yeah.
Is that what he said?
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about that. I thought you were talking about the poop in the butt.
Well,
sorry.
We already said it. All right.
Sorry.
My son has comedic timing. My wife, unfortunately, does not. So.
Sorry. You were yelling at him for something,
and he said, chill with that bullshit.
Oh, yeah. We were at dinner. We were having dinner.
Yeah.
He's like, Mom, just chill with that bullshit.
And then you called me and told me.
Oh, yeah. I'm like, do you know what your son just said?
I was crying laughing. Well, I think he's.
Sorry about that.
He's been providing me with some gems that I've been writing down that are going to. They're so good, it's going to be part of the closer on this new hour special. So
yeah.
He's been very entertaining.
He really
I'm a little
has.
Nervous. I pray to God he does want to do this.
Yeah.
All right. Well, part of the fun is watching clips.
Okay.
So we picked two clips of people that when we started dating, especially, you would come out on the road with me. And as someone who's never, like, traveled really outside of Minnesota, you know, now all of a sudden you're on tour with a touring comic. Like, what are those first few months like? Because then you got used to it. And,
yeah.
But,
it was
but
so
at the beginning,
fun. It was so much fun.
Yeah.
Traveling and going to the show and hanging out and... You know, that was before kids.
Yeah.
But, it was so much fun.
At the time, though, you're touring with people that now are a lot bigger. But back then, we're all just comics. We're just comics touring. So you would spend time with some of these comics. So I thought it'd be fun to maybe watch a comic or two.
Okay.
And then you could share a reflection or opinion on what you think of this person. So this is number three. Let's see who we got here. This is... Sebastian Maniscalco. Now, when you moved to LA, we were all still at the Comedy Store, hanging out quite a bit, touring. Any initial thoughts when I say Sebastian? What are the thoughts that come to your mind?
He's so particular.
Very particular,
He's a good guy. He's so funny.
Yeah.
I mean, we've had some nice dinners way back when we lived there. But
sure.
Yeah. he's just the feet thing. Anyways, I'm interested to see what clip it is.
Okay, let's watch Sebastian. Here we go.
Finally found someone who could deal with me. I got married last year, and I'm happier than shit, I gotta tell you. My wife is an angel, okay? A complete angel. Did the total opposite of me, okay? Loves people. Loves people. She's from the South. She's always smiling. She's like a dog. She likes to play. She likes to come out and play. I'm like a cat. I love to hide. Right? Her friends come over. They're like comfortable. Right? I like people at the house, but like her friends stay long. Like my friends, after the game, they're gone. Hers, they're like, oh, I'll just sleep at night. Her friends like open the refrigerator. I'm sorry, I didn't grow up that way. You don't open anybody else's refrigerator, right? The refrigerator in the master bedroom, you don't look at. You ever get a tour of somebody's house and this is the master and you're like, oh, okay. You don't go in there and go, oh, this is where you fuck? You fuck? Right here. Oh. You just skip it and you move on to the baby's room. No, a friend came over the other night. She goes, come here. She goes in there, starts shopping like it's Jewel. Huh? Took out a bowl of cherries, beautiful cherries. I just bought them, right? I didn't even get to taste them. What I like to do is I like to take out the cherries, put them in a separate bowl, give a nice wash, and slip those in the refrigerator, right? This one takes out the cherries. She's eating the cherries, and she's talking to me and my wife. Now, it's all over my face. I can't hide it, right? I'm sitting there, I go to the bathroom. Now I go hide. I go like a cat, I go somewhere else. my wife has to come get me. She's like, why? Would you come out here? I go, she's eating a cherry. How does she know I'm not making a cherry pie with that? But that's why I fell in love with my wife. Totally different. I'll come home and the pizza delivery guy will be in the house while my wife goes to our secret stash and pays him. I go, why is the delivery guy in our kitchen? I didn't grow up with delivery people. I was the delivery person.
Oh my God.
That's so funny.
I just remember a horrible memory.
What?
Are you ready?
What?
I remember the first time I brought you to the Comedy Store, I had you watch Sebastian. I'm like, you got to see this guy. He's so great. He's a good friend, et cetera, et cetera. We went out afterwards. We're having a great time. And everything he's saying, obviously, is hilarious, right?
Yeah.
We're both dying laughing.
Yeah.
You're laughing like a little too hard. And do you remember we came home that night? I'm like, you know, we had a few drinks. I'm like, why the fuck are you laughing at him so hard?
Oh, yeah.
Like, you don't think I'm that funny?
Yeah.
And I was so, you know, we're starting to date and insecure or whatever.
Yeah.
But I was like, you know, I remember going to bed that night like, ah, he's damn funny though. Yeah, he's just so funny. But do you have any recollections or thoughts when you see Sebastian and all those times we'd hang out at the store and then go out for a bite before or after? And
but you know. I mean, it was constant laughing. So
yeah.
Because he's like that.
Oh.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time. And his wife is so sweet.
Yes.
Like, just so, 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 so sweet. But it's so funny that they're opposites like that.
Oh, my God, One of my favorite lines Sebastian had, I don't know if he ever put it in a bit, but we both have a disdain for humanity.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he doesn't like humanity. Like, I in social settings, it's like, if you're in a line, be as expedient as possible. Mm-hmm. If you're at a traffic light, be as expedient as possible. That's my thing. I don't like wasting my time. I don't like wasting anybody else's time, right? Sebastian, the human experience is a toil to him. I think the movie I Am Legend is his dream. Like, he just needs a German Shepherd and a Mustang, and he'll be happy. But I remember he had this line, and it made me laugh so hard. We were just bitching about something, and he goes, I fucking can't stand people, but they're everywhere. And it was the way he said it. I'm like, oh, my God.
That is fitting for you.
Yeah. But the way he says it and the way just his absolute lack of patience for, you know, decorum.
Yes.
I think there's a sense of decorum and just like you want to be as respectful as possible. Uh-huh. And he found a way to channel that into his stand-up comedy. Me, I've never really addressed it, you know, but I get my blood boils, and I've never been able to connect the wires when I've talked about it.
I know. For someone who
doesn't
like being around people, you sure go to the movies a lot.
Tell them. What happened?
We've had terrible experiences at the movies.
I always say, lately. I go, is it just me? Like, I have this gravity where if I go to a room of 300 people, the worst person will end up sitting next to me.
Right next to you.
Well, tell them
right
happened
next
at Top
to
Gun.
Yeah. This woman sitting next to Steve will not stop talking. So
throughout
loud.
Previews.
And it's one thing during the
previews.
Previews,
I give
fine.
It to you.
But then the movie started, and she's still going.
Still going.
And so what did you say to her?
I do my heavy sigh.
Yes, of course.
Which you've heard many times. Tell them about the heavy sigh.
Oh, God.
The kids know I do this.
Yeah, the kids know.
So we'll be in line, and what happens?
Someone will come too close to you or take too long, and that's what you do. Oh, God. Oh.
I don't make any bones about it. If you're taking too much time, or if you go to McDonald's, if you go to McDonald's and you're like, what's good here? I'll go, I'll just let it out there in the universe to know someone is agitated by this, and it's me. Move it the fuck along. I can't stand it. So the kids know I do it.
Yes. Yeah.
And now this woman
and
at
so
Top
this
Gun.
Lady, it just set her off even more. And she's like, shut the fuck up. She said, and then the you up. Were talking, you know, you were, the movie's going on. Like, be quiet. We're trying to watch.
I said to her, the film's starting now. Can we please keep it down?
Yeah, yeah.
She goes, you want me to keep it down? I'm not going to keep it down. I'll punch you in your fucking face.
Yeah.
And that's when I got up. And I said, okay.
Yeah, you got up. I got up and followed. I'm like, I'm not staying here. Let's get out of here.
Yeah, but even last film we went to, Jurassic Park.
Yeah, the lady next to you.
Lady next to
you. Talking the entire time, asking questions to her friend. But that went over a little bit better. You just said to her.
I said, ladies, can we please keep it down?
And then
they but it just like, again, it's like there's no decorum out there in society in general. I think we're just a slob nation. Nobody cares. Go to the airport every week. There's an experience I have. It's nonstop. But anyway, Sebastian's found a way to really tap into that, and he's made a career out of being disgusted by everybody.
By everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah. His flip-flop sandal thing is just my favorite with men.
Yeah, it's funny because he says things that are so resonant that when you're in the experience of real life, you go, oh, Sebastian. That's his bit. You know, you just say those things.
Yes.
Yeah. He's great.
Yeah.
But he does, like, when he's talking about the cherries, he does appreciate, like, cooking and creating and preparing. And he would watch one of these chefs on TV. And I remember one time he invited me over and he got fresh prosciutto wrapped around, like bacon and, like broccoli or something. Like, he wrapped them and he took time to put toothpicks through them. And it was just like, we were laughing because I was like, I can't believe we're doing this together, man. You're the best. But he's so successful, as he should be. He's a great guy, and he deserves. He's one of the truly, like, great guys in comedy.
Yeah.
And I think, like you were saying, nothing's changed. He's
that is him.
Yeah.
It's him and everything. I mean, it's their home, right? Like, picture everything in place.
Yeah.
Where it should be. That is, like, that's him.
Yeah, when you go to the Grove in Los Angeles, which is like a high-end mall, they have a trolley that goes 100 yards from like Nordstrom's to to the parking lot area. I mean, you could walk it in 5 minutes, but they have a trolley there. And when we first moved to L.A., like Sebastian's there, he's at the Grove every day, eating, enjoying the finer things of life. And, you know, after his pedicure, he'll go there. And I always teased him. I was like, one day the trolley from the Grove is going to drop you off at the Comedy Store. I just know one day. But lots of love to Sebastian, obviously, and his family. So let's go to this one. Here we go.
Oh, Colin.
Colin Jost. What are your thoughts on Colin?
I love Colin. He's such a great guy and so funny.
Oh, my God.
And so smart. But just hilarious.
Well, you would come out with me on the road, and Colin would come out quite a bit. And this is when Colin was just a writer on SNL.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just writing. I don't even know if he was head writer yet, but he wanted to do more stand-up. And the Tampa Bay comes to mind. Remember Nassim came? And you and Nassim watched like 8 shows in a row together. And I was like, girls, you can do anything but this. Because he was dating Nassim at the
time. Yeah. We did watch 8 shows.
I thought that was crazy.
Yeah, I think I started
drinking.
What are
you thinking when you're watching the same set on Saturday at midnight? You're like, what is going through your head? Are you like, I should get the fuck out? Like,
no, like, I'll have a drink, please. I mean, I'll have a drink.
It can't be fun, though.
It is. I mean,
hearing the same stuff?
Well, I know, but
repeatedly?
Yeah, but sometimes, you know, you miss things or, like, in a situation like that, if her and I were talking and we missed stuff, you know, then you pay attention. I mean, sometimes you catch new things.
Here's what I love about Colin. Colin seems like he's got it all together, right?
Yeah.
You look at him. He's this handsome, charismatic, Ivy League, went to Harvard. Like, everything's there. He's got his life in order. And then you hang out with him, and a little spacey sometimes, right?
Sometimes.
Do you remember we went to his house to go eat, to go out to lunch? And we pull up to this really nice home, and we go up to the door, and we're knocking on the door. Do you remember what happened?
No.
Kent's knocking on the door, and there's plate glass-like window off to the side of the door.
Oh.
And so Kent's knocking on the door. We're all standing there huddled.
Oh, because it was raining.
Pouring rain outside. And what is Colin doing? He's making faces at Kent. behind the and we're like, dude, open.
Can we come in?
It's fucking
it's raining.
And then what happened when he went to get the car for Scarlett? Do you remember what happened?
Well, I think she was left standing out in the rain.
She was left standing outside in the pouring rain. Colin starts the car and he's sitting in it and she's out there in the pouring rain. And she looks at us like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
And then he goes, oh, my God. He gets out, runs out, and pulls his golf club. He's sitting in the car. His golf clubs are next to him in the car. And you would think, where's she going to fucking sit, dummy? And then she's standing there looking at us. And then he came out and pulled the golf clubs out. And she was pregnant at the time, too,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you got
yeah.
your pregnant wife out there in the pouring rain because your golf clubs are sitting in the front row. Oh, my God. Well, I love Colin. Colin's just such a talented
Colin's
guy. Just did the road with him. And I think I might have told you about this, but the guy does an hour and 10 minutes every night. And this is what he would do when he was opening for me. This is what he does when he's in the theater in front of 2,000 people. He'll have his core set, right? So if it's a 30-minute set, he'll have his core 15 minutes. If it's an hour and 15, he'll have his core 45 minutes, right? But he goes up. Every single time I've worked with him and I've seen him, and he'll have a new 20 minutes.
Wow.
He writes prolifically. And the one time we did it, we had done the show the night before. We woke up at 9 o'clock, went and golfed all day, got home, showered, rushed to the venue, and he's on stage and he had memorized 20 new minutes.
Oh my God.
And I'm sitting there going, when did you do that? He's like, oh, these are just thoughts I've had of like getting it out. I'm like, how do you do that? It's unbelievable. He's so prolific. And by the way, they're really good jokes. They're really good jokes, as you would expect from a head writer of SNL. But jokes have a rhythm to it.
Right.
And so you're discovering the rhythm. So I'm watching him like just say it for the first time. It works.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And it's only going to get better.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable to me. So let's watch a Colin Jost clip here.
My girlfriend and I broke up. We used to fight all the time, you know. It's amazing, like, when couples fight, what do they fight about? Is it ever important stuff? No, it's always the stupidest stuff in the world. My girlfriend and I were walking down the street. We saw a girl walking down the street holding her shoes in her hand. She was walking barefoot. My girlfriend was like, well, she's dumb and drunk. I was like, maybe your feet just hurt. She's like, why are you defending her? We fought for an hour and a half about a stranger we would never see again. Have you ever fight so long, you just start fighting about the fight you're having? Like, the original argument's over, you think you're out of the woods, and then she's like, you know, I wish you wouldn't get so frustrated when we fought. And you're like, I wish you wouldn't say crazy shit all the time. And you're fighting for another 2 hours. And eventually, it's like the movie Inception. There's a fight within a fight within a fight. And somewhere, the two of you are in a van falling off a bridge in slow motion. And she's like, this is your fault. And you're like, but you're the one driving. My favorite expression from your girlfriend, though, is, I wish we spent more quality time together. That's my best. Quality time. That's my favorite expression. One morning, my girlfriend and I spent the entire morning in bed. We had breakfast in bed. We watched a movie. We had sex. She was like, yeah, but that's not quality time. She said, quality time isn't when you're eating or watching a movie or having sex. I was like, you just named literally my three favorite activities. I think when women use the phrase quality time, what they imagine in their head is just the two of you alone in an empty warehouse. Sitting in two plastic folding chairs, just staring into each other's eyes, petting a newborn puppy. And every 15 minutes, you apologize for something you don't remember doing. That is quality time. Thank you guys very much. You guys are a fantastic audience.
Oh, that's great. It's so funny, like, to even see those bits, because at that time, when he was, it's funny to watch him now, too, because he's a lot slower.
Oh, yeah.
His pace is a lot slower, but those are bits he did at the beginning of his stand-up career that I'm like, oh, my God, I know these all beat for beat, word for word, and they're great. But after having just worked with him, I'm like, oh, my God, he's so much slower now.
Yeah.
I think that's the case with most comics. I'll watch something from early on, even in mine, and I'm rapid fire, as opposed to now it's a lot more. It's just a comfortability, I guess.
Yeah.
But
So you know his bits like I know yours.
Aw. Aw.
No, Colin is the best.
I think he's, oh my God,
our
some of his new stuff
story,
too.
Our wedding story? Are you going to tell that?
What's that?
The wedding story.
Oh, when
our wedding?
When he came to our, yeah. Well, we're getting married in Chicago. Well, anytime he mentions the wedding in Chicago, he mentions Whirly Ball the night before our honeymoon when we were playing Whirly Ball till 4 in the morning.
Uh-huh.
And I came back and just in time for our...
Yeah, that's how you're starting our marriage. Showing up like
hanging out with my friends
20 minutes before we had to leave for our,
yeah,
for our flight.
Yeah, to go to Belize.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
it was just so much fun.
It was the best. But Colin, we're at Whirly Ball. We had gone there two nights in a row, I think.
And it was the night before our wedding.
The night before our wedding, we go, that's right. So we're at Whirly Ball. And Whirly Ball is basically like a magnetized basketball court with bumper cars on it and like lacrosse nets. And so you're in bumper cars, drunk, hitting each other, trying to get the ball in the net.
Yeah, it's a bar.
It's the funnest game.
It's the best place.
It's so fun. So we had done it the night before I was getting married, and off to the side they have video games, and they have a punching bag. Now, we're with Chicago police officers that box and train, and all of us are taking turns drilling it as hard as we can. And these guys are, like, annihilating this thing. And Colin, the Harvard grad, comes over and... and drills it, and it goes up, and he's like, yeah, I did it. And we're all, yeah, Colin.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And we're getting married the next day. We walk up to get a first round of pictures after the ceremony, and we didn't really see anybody. And up on the terrace, Colin waves to us, and his arm's in a cast.
like, oh, my God.
What's wrong? He's like, well, I broke my hand on the punching game because I don't think Colin had ever been in a fight in his life. But
so our wedding night was memorable for us and for Colin.
And for Colin because he was in the emergency room the day before. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, God.
When you say, like, I know your bits, is there a joke that just comes out that you think that's one of your favorites?
Oh, gosh. Well, so I will say this, because of the kids, I don't travel as much with you as I used to. But
so
like,
you don't
when
see the new stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think you've seen this newest version of it in.
It's been a while.
Yeah,
it's been a while. But when we were younger, and I used to travel with you all the time.
Yeah.
I could do your hour.
Beat for beat.
Yeah, for sure. I always liked the relationship stuff.
Yeah.
And like, you know, I mean the homeless guy shitting on the sidewalk is a prime example, because back when you would tell that joke, you'd really use it as an example of how different we are, because we are very different.
Yes.
And what we think is funny, and it would go into the joke about boys and girls, right? That boys get a truck.
Sure, yeah.
Like, and I loved that
right
material. I mean, one, because I felt like I could relate, because I was that teacher who had to break it to the girls that
right, yeah,
you're gonna be bleeding, you know, like that type of thing.
Right.
I really liked that stuff. But I like the men and women stuff.
Yeah.
And I know you don't talk about the kids a lot, but I like that as well.
Yeah, we'll see on this new one. But yeah, I think probably the next time you see it will be when we tape it.
Yeah.
Most likely. But, I can't thank you enough for joining me, Jess. I love you so much, and I'm so glad you're here. And how was it? Because you were very nervous before.
I still am nervous.
Are you really?
Yes.
Really? Why? It's over. You did it.
I know, but I'm still nervous.
Well, that's a part also why I don't try. Like, when we did, we've gone to premieres and stuff, and you're always like, no, 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 I don't want to go out there. I don't want to go out there. You're like the opposite of most of my friends' wives, mm-hmm, who want their picture taken on the red carpet or whatever like that. You've always shied away from it, so you've always stayed away from it. And that's also why I've been a little more respectful in not, showboating you or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I know this is hard for you, so I really appreciate you coming out here today. I really do, on the podcast.
Thank you, hon.
But would you do it again?
Let's see how many people listen to the first one.
Okay, that's true. That's true. Okay. Well, I cannot thank my very special guest this week, my lovely wife, Jessica, for joining me.
Thanks,
our son. Daughter's watching Stranger Things in the green room, so we're going to get her out of here. But thank you guys again for watching another episode of Comedy Pinata. One thing I've noticed in the comments is a lot of people saying, this show should be so much bigger. than what it is. Now, look, I know we're getting started here, but if you enjoy the show, if you're a big comedy fan, and you know somebody that's a comedy fan, just share it. Spread the word. Spread the gospel. We really appreciate it. We know we're getting started with this, and I'll start carpet bombing other shows and letting people know about it. But I really appreciate all the support. This has been a total blast, and thanks to Taylor and George and, of course, Adrian for all their work and for episodes like this, which are kind of like a curveball. But for me, it's a lot of fun. It's been something I've been wanting to do for a while, so I appreciate it. Thank you so much, Jess.
You're welcome. All right. This episode's for you.
Love you. All right. Thank you guys again. Rate, review, subscribe, all that good stuff, and let your friends know. Okay. Take care.